It took about half a minute for Gaara to notice that he and Tamari weren't alone. What are they doing here? Gaara demanded, glaring at Naruto, who was still sitting slumped against the tree.
They...
Tamari trailed off. Naruto nearly chuckled at her uncertainty. Aren't a problem right now. Tamari eventually settled on. Naruto swallowed her emotion so she could be squad leader again. We knew the Akatsuki was coming after you, so we came to try and kill them. What she said was true, but it tasted like a lie. And some other things. But Tamari is right. We aren't enemies right now. And the sand village? Gaara asked again to Tamari. Still standing. It hasn't been that long since you were captured. All the same, we should hurry back. And one of mine is currently in your hospital, so I'm coming with. Naruto declares. That was yet another mistake she had made. Sending Kakashi back to the sand village to be treated. What if Naruto's actions really had turned the sand village hostile? Kakashi would have been doomed. You helped save me? Gaara asked, sounding incredulous. He knew she hated him, yet it was the only explanation for why the Akatsuki had been defeated. I suppose you could say that. In truth, others were more responsible for that than I. Your sister among them, as well as my other teammate here. Naruto said, crouching down next to the still paralyzed keeper. I'll explain everything later, she whispered to him. She owed him a very big apology, as well as Kakashi. Those who break the rules are scum, but those who abandon their friends are worse than scum. Kakashi had always given her some leeway due to her father. She wondered what he'd think of her now. What her father would think of her now. And so they made their way back to the sand village, Tamari sealing up and taking Lady Tio's corpse with her. We owe your team a great debt. I cannot give you full run of the village, but you may stay in designated rooms in the hospital for as long as you need to recover. Gaara said to Naruto, and she looked uncertain. If you feel the need to immediately transfer your comrades to your own village, I understand that too. No, we'll stay to recover, Naruto decided. Beyond letting Kiba and Kakashi recover, Naruto herself could use some time to gather her thoughts before returning to the leaf, and more specifically, to the Hokage. She had deliberately chosen to abandon an important mission due to nothing but a gut feeling that it was the right thing to do. Not right for Konoha even, but simply, right. If she was anybody else, there was no doubt she'd be forced to go rogue ninja, since returning meant a court-martial with a possible execution. As it was, Naruto knew she was invaluable. Taking her into custody would be risky. Trying to transfer the Kyuubi to another host would be even more risky. And even if all that went smoothly, that new Jinchuriki would need years to be trained up. That said, something of this magnitude? Danzu would have to give her some kind of punishment beyond simply not promoting her to Jonin as was the original plan. Some kind of restrictions on her freedom? Placing her on a squad with strangers? More immediate lessons? Or something much worse? After Naruto had seen how good Danzo was at hypnosis when she saw him control the Ninetales, she and Sakura had agreed upon a system where they'd regularly check each other for genjutsu brainwashing, so they'd have some kind of defense against that. Would he be willing to go that far? From everything Naruto knew about Danzo, the answer would be a yes if he thought he could get away with it. But that was for later. Right now she had comrades to look after and apologize to. She had expected that Kiba would be the first one, but then Sakura started to lecture her on her decisions.
I don't get it. You knew everything. If your father was making wrong decisions, why didn't you say something?
I was okay with the main objective. I wasn't okay with lying and deceiving our friends to get there.
Then why didn't you say something? I trust that you know what you were doing. Why? What about anything has ever convinced you I know what I'm doing? I was trusting that you'd let me know if I was making a mistake. You're saying it's my fault now? What? No, never!
There was a few seconds of silence before the tension seemed to drain out of Sakura.
Well, Maybe it is partly my fault. If I disagreed with anything, I should have said something before, rather than complain now. I was complicit.
Naruko opened her mouth to object, but Sakura silenced her with a gesture.
You know what our problem is? We both believe that the other is perfect.
Naruko thought about that, and thought that maybe Sakura had a point.
Well, you're more perfect than me.
My point exactly.
From now on, I'll try to share my thoughts more, provided you promise to do the same. That was something Naruko readily agreed with.
Next, it was time to face Kiba and explain everything that had happened. He was lying down on a hospital bed, awake. They were thankfully alone.
Honestly, I guessed most of it already. Not trying to undersell it, what you did was pretty shitty. But everything worked out in the end.
Did it? We abandoned our mission, and who knows what will happen now.
Who is this we? I completed my mission just fine.
Kiba grinned at her.
Ass, Naruko said without any real heat. But what do you make of all this? You obviously wanted to save Gaara, but that goes contrary to the Okage's wishes.
Almost treasonous, isn't it?
Kiba said lightly.
It's not as clear-cut as it used to be. You'd both know if you'd spent more time in Konoha these last few years. If disagreeing with Okage was treason, Konoha would lose half its ninja.
Me and Sakura probably among them, Naruko thought.
Beyond lying to you, I put you in danger.
Naruko went back to her apology.
I should have never sent you alone against one of the Akatsuki. Tamari was there as well, but she was a dubious ally at the time.
Yeah, again, that was pretty shitty of you, Kiba again said bluntly.
But at least it gave me a chance to show off a little. We can't have you stealing the spotlight all the time now, can we?
Show off in front of that pretty sand Kanocha, you mean?
Sakura teased. Kiba's expression darkened.
Bah! Tamari's a total babe, yeah. But she would have let Lady Chiyo imprison or even kill me, even after everything I did. Woman doesn't deserve me.
Thank goodness. That's one entanglement our team really doesn't need.
Kiba grinned and winked at her.
Besides, I've still got my eye on you.
Do you now?
Naruko said.
I've never crushed on you the way I crushed on Sasuke. But we do recognize you're a nice guy. We could do a lot worse. At least we should give you a chance, so... sure, she said, grinning.
Kiba sputtered. That hadn't been the response he'd been expecting. He'd been half joking. Not that he was disappointed, not at all.
Yeah, of course. I'll show you a good time.
Wait, did that sound bad? Oh man.
Relax, it's not all up to you. Naruko and I will decide on a proper date, Sakura said.
Wait, you're saying you and Naruko will decide where I'll take Naruko?
Sakura put on a show of looking hurt. We're saying that me and Sakura will decide where you'll take the both of us, Naruko explained.
Like, one after the other?
At the same time, of course, Sakura said. Now smiling like a warrior smelling weakness. Naruko threw an arm around Sakura's shoulder and gave Kiba an almost predatory grin.
I thought you'd realize by now. Sakura and I are as close as can be. We share everything. Everything.
Kiba grew pale. Naruko and Sakura were both Kunochis with very strong personalities. Both would be considered alphas in most packs. Just handling one of them without being domesticated would be a challenge. But both?
Kiba could see it clearly in his mind's eye. Whenever they'd decide what to do, he'd be outvoted. He'd be dragged along through shopping spree after shopping spree, being used as nothing but a simple pack mule. They'd make him stay at home and take away any shred of his independence.
Never!
Kiba screamed and jumped out of the hospital window. Not even the chance at a threesome was worth that.
I'm a man! A true wild beast, not some lab dog! A man! A man!
Naruko and Sakura exchanged bemused expressions.
I guess he's not interested,
Naruko said, and then both of them started laughing. The next day, when Sakura had managed to treat Kakashi well enough for him to wake up, they gave him the full story as well. He didn't take it nearly as well as Kiba. Naruko could practically see the respect he had for her melt away as she told him everything.
There is no denying that in terms of pure combat skills, you're at minimum at a high Jonin level. However, it seems like you have a long way to go before you're even ready to be a Chunin.
I know, Naruko said.
Acknowledging your mistake and feeling sorry isn't enough here. If you were a genin under my command, I'd drop you from the ninja program.
Those who break the rules are scum, but those who abandon their friends are worse than scum. I know. I figured this would be your reaction.
Yes. Forgiving you isn't even the real issue here. You are following the Hokage's instructions, as most of Konoha's ninjas do. Would you even need forgiveness for such a thing?
I suppose it doesn't matter. I'm just disappointed. I'd hoped you'd be better than all that.
You expected me to be my father, Naruko said. Perhaps that was asking too much. We might never see his like again. Still, I cannot help but be disappointed.
I had hoped you'd be the next Hokage after Danzo, but this is not encouraging.
What would my father have made of all this? Naruko asked, and then proceeded to tell Kakashi the view of her father that Danzo had shared with her. A man of duty and unquestionable service to Konoha, who had killed thousands.
Naruko could tell that Kakashi was bothered by the interpretation.
He did do those things, Kakashi admitted.
He looked like he wanted to say more, but didn't know what.
The more people I talked to, the fewer people actually seemed to have known him. Was he ruthless or compassionate? A romantic idealist or a dutiful soldier?
He always seemed like all those things to me, Kakashi said.
I still can't imagine him approving of your actions this mission.
Good, neither do I, Naruko said.
I could say something like, you're still young, you've got time to figure it out. But I fear that the hour is late, and events are moving fast. You can still become the hero we all hoped you could be, but you must do it soon.
Naruko didn't know how to do that, but she figured that a good place to start would be to accept Gaara's request to come talk to him. She no longer wanted him dead, but she still didn't want to be around him. Neither did Sakura for that matter, but she still came along. And just like Sakura was shadowing Naruko, so too did Temari shadow Gaara. Naruko and Gaara met on top of the cliff surrounding the sand village, where he wouldn't be easily overheard. Gaara stood facing his village below, and only turned his head briefly to look at her.
From everything Temari told me, it's clear you didn't come here just to oppose the Akatsuki. Nor were you here to help mend the relationship between our villages, as you claimed when you first arrived. How much of the truth are you willing to tell me?
The Hokage wanted you dead, and to be honest, so did I, Naruko stated bluntly.
The blunt admission seemed to surprise him.
I expected as much, but I also suspected you to dance around it. Won't sharing such a secret add to your shame of abandoning your mission?
As you said, you guessed most of it already, so I don't see the point.
I know deception should be part of our trade as ninja, but I tried that, it didn't work. And even if it would have worked...
Naruko couldn't quite put it into words, and she didn't want to share such personal thoughts with Gaara in any event. So Naruko just shook her head.
Then I guess my next question is why?
Why I wanted you dead? The implication that he might have forgotten caused her temper to flare.
No, that's not surprising. Lots of people want me dead. I'm wondering why you didn't finish me off when you could have, especially when you were ordered to do so.
Naruko wasn't listening to that last sentence. She was still stuck on the first, and the implications made her furious.
Lots of people want you dead, you say? Like mine are the same petty reasons as those who hate you because you're a jinchuriki. You killed someone very precious to me, just because she was there. Maybe other people are like that too. Maybe some start to hate you because of petty reasons, but you are responsible for giving them more. How many friends, sons, daughters, or parents have you killed over the years?
Plenty, gotta admit. Though not recently. Which again brings me back to my question. Why spare me?
Because this world isn't served by your removal from it. Not anymore.
That was probably the single most reluctant compliment God had ever received. Yet it felt all the more sincere because of it.
Please tell me why you think so. Gara asked, seeming almost desperate for the answer. You're one of the few figures that is trying to push against what's coming. My teammate told me that. If you want to thank anyone for changing my mind, you should thank him. I am trying to push against the tide, I mean. But I'm also failing. But with your help, maybe. What do you need me to do?
Talk to your Okage. I've tried to reach out to him countless times without success, yet he must hear me, before I'm forced to take drastic measures.
Now you're threatening us?
Have you looked at my village? There isn't enough food and water to go around.
Your first mistake was building a village in the middle of a desert, Naruko interrupted, but Gara ignored her.
And it's because of your village, Uzumaki. It's going out of its way to suffocate me and mine. The reason for why my father originally agreed to attack Konoha are more true than ever. I don't want to be your enemy. I don't want to be anybody's enemy. But what can I do when desperate villagers look to me for a solution?
Alright. She did see his point. And what can I do to help? Because I do want what you want here.
Again, talk to your Okage. Make him see.
I doubt he'll be pleased with me after this. He won't listen.
Then there is no hope.
Naruto grimaced.
Kakashi says I can still be the hero they all hoped I can be.
Maybe I spoke too soon. It's wrong to give up so easily. I will do my part in ending this. I don't know how, but I will.
Regardless of how it turns out, you'll let me know.
I promise. And regardless, I promise not to take any hostile actions against the Sand Village, no matter what. It has clearly suffered enough.
Gara turned to face her fully, and extended a hand for her to shake. After a moment's hesitation, Naruko did so. Gara pretended not to notice how she wiped her hand with her pants afterwards, as if she had just touched something slimy. Gara would have liked to be friends, but he'd take being allies for now.
If there is anything I can do to help you, let me know as well.
And that was how Naruko's least favorite person in the world became one of her most important allies. They stayed for 3 more days for Kakashi to fully recover. He was well enough to travel after just 1 more day, but he wanted to be fully recovered before returning to Konoha. It was a weird feeling that the Sand Village might be a safer place for them to recover than Konoha. But with Naruko having just blatantly gone against the Okage's wishes, they couldn't be sure of anything. Just before they headed out, Gaara told them that the fighting had broken out between the Cloud and the Leaf's forces in the Land of Waterfall. It seemed that the 4th Great Ninja War had officially begun. On the one hand, this was terrible, but Naruko also couldn't help but think this made it even less likely that Danzo would punish her that severely. He would need her now more than ever. When they returned, they found the Hidden Leaf Village emptier than usual. Most active shinobi having been deployed in the field somewhere. Naruko and Sakura had braced themselves for a heated conversation with the Okage. What they hadn't expected was the news that he shared upon seeing them.
I am sorry to say that your mentors, Jiraiya and Tsunade, have both been killed in action.
What?
No.
Naruko and Sakura reacted respectively. So Danzo told them of their ill-fated investigation into the Hidden Rain Village. Danzo kept his outward expression sympathetic, but inwardly, he allowed himself to feel a bit of satisfaction at the Tokunochi's anguished expressions. Gaara had issued a proclamation about the Sand Village's attempted stance of neutrality into the whole world. So Danzo knew they had failed their mission to kill the Kage. Receiving this news was a worse punishment than anything Danzo would have been able to deliver otherwise. Two summoned animals, a slug and a toad, were present at the office, both here to deliver the Sanin's final gift for their pupils. For Naruko, a coded document with as much information about Pain and Konan that they had been able to discover, along with a more personal letter, written before the battle in case things went poorly. For Sakura, Tsunade had left her her necklace, the necklace of the first Hokage. If Danzo believed he could have gotten away with it, he would have withheld the necklace and sold it to fund the war effort. It was worth a small mountain of gold, and its only practical use was in suppressing Biju chakra and enhancing the Senju bloodline, none of which would be relevant in Sakura's hands. It was just a big waste of a resource. But the slug summons knew who Tsunade had wanted the necklace to go to. If Danzo withheld that inheritance, the summons would have no doubt snitched on him. Under normal circumstances, I would allow you a day to grieve, but events are moving too fast for such things. I must have your report about what happened in the Land of Wind. And so Naruko gave Danzo a mostly accurate report. The only big alteration was why she couldn't use the Elder Toads to use Sage Mode. She still wanted to maintain the lie that she and the Ninetales were cooperating. But that of course left a big hole in her story. Instead of trying to risk everything on being able to use Senjutsu, why not simply use the Ninetales' chakra? I didn't feel like I needed it, and as it turns out, I didn't. I don't want the Akatsuki to know the full extent of my powers just yet. I take it you will want to use that full extent of your powers on the leaders of the Hidden Rain Village? Or will you forgive them as easily as you did Gaara? I would like to confront them, yes. Confront? Such a nicely vague term. In any case, you will not be going to the Rain Village. You will go to the Land of Waterfall to counter the possibility of Kumo's Jinchuriki taking the field against us. Only you. Haruno will go to a different front. From their expressions, they knew them being separated was yet another way that they were being punished for their failure. You seem awfully eager to jump right into this conflict, Naruko says. The Sand Village is trying to stay neutral. Why can't we? What's even the point of this war?
Peace, Danzo said seriously.
Naruko actually snorted, and Sakura just looked unimpressed.
I'm serious, Danzo said. You are Jiraiya's student. No doubt he has exposited about the cycle of hatred to you many times to the point of nausea. How the great nations constantly try to compete and dominate each other, causing unimaginable suffering to both ourselves and the whole world.
Yes, it was Jiraiya's dream to stop all that.
As it is mine, Danzo said. No, really. Jiraiya and I wanted the same thing. Only the lengths we were willing to go to achieve it differ. Jiraiya was unwilling to accept any path that would require him to truly fight for what he believed in.
Careful, Naruko said, actually drawing on a minuscule sliver of the Kyuubi's power before the fox stopped it, letting her eyes glow red. I'm really not in the mood to hear you badmouthing Jiraiya right now.
Tell me I'm wrong. He talked a great deal about peace, but what did he actually do?
There was silence.
That wasn't a rhetorical question.
He tried to teach me and whoever he could, Naruko said. That and he wrote books, but he doubted that answer would impress Danzo.
He did try to teach you, yes. He hoped that you could come up with a solution, whereas he could not. But Jiraiya had years to think of a path to everlasting peace. Don't you think it's irresponsible to put such a burden on you? The burden to think of a solution to a problem where he, in over 25 years, could not.
He simply wanted to have faith in me.
Yes. His search towards the so-called Child of Prophecy. The scorn in Danzo's voice was obvious. That, more than anything else, illustrates my point.
He didn't try to better the world himself. He didn't think he could. He simply hoped to find the one who could. Danzo gave her an intense look. And maybe he did. With your help, and the power of the Ninetales, Jiraiya's dream may yet come to fruition.
Yes, by telling you to call off your troops. Call for a Kage summit and talk your problems out like adults instead of squabbling like children.
Careful. I'm making allowances due to your grief, but there is a limit, Danzo warned. Naruko just glared, as did Sakura for that matter. Danzo stood up and looked out of the window, out over the leaf village and the Hokage monument. To get back to my earlier point, for 5 generations now, the great villages have strived against each other. It's like a game where each move anybody makes costs innocent lives. It needs to end.
Then end it. You were the one pushing for this conflict. You can stop it as well.
And what would that accomplish? Officially, the war started 2 days ago. But in reality, we never stopped fighting during our last so-called peace. Except instead of armies, we sent spies and assassins, trying to steal each other's bloodlines and techniques, taking any opportunity to strengthen ourselves while weakening the enemy, to increase our chances when open hostilities resumed. If we stopped fighting now, we would simply return to that. Not to mention that the terms of surrender we'd have to agree to would leave us worse off for the next conflict.
Then this is better?
Yes. As I said, the competition between the great villages is like a game. And what is the best, most sure way for a game to end? Danzo waited for them to answer, and when they didn't, he finished. Make sure that someone finally wins. Konoha has won every war it's ever fought, but in the end, we never got anything out of it. A failure of leadership, I call it. A mistake born out of the ideals of people like Hiruzen and Hashirama before him. They wanted peace for mutual understanding, and so were reluctant to go as far as they needed to go. How much trouble could have been avoided if in the last war, your father finished the job and razed the Hidden Stone Village to the ground? I will not make such a mistake. Like the Sand Village, all the other villages will be defanged, and steps will be taken so that they will never rise again. Naruko took an involuntary step backwards from the shock of what was being suggested here.
I've seen what that leads to, she said, and then told Danzo of how bad the people of the Sand Village now had it.
The people of the Hidden Sand aren't my responsibility, nor are they yours. I am the Hokage, and you are a ninja from the Hidden Leaf. It is our solemn duty to look after the welfare of the Hidden Leaf Village and Fire Country as a whole. Which I have done. We are better off now than we were back before the Sound Sand invasion. And once all the other villages have been taken care of for good, we'll have room to expand even more. There will be nobody left to compete against, and we'll finally have true peace.
Naruko slowly shook her head. This is not what Jiraiya wanted.
Danzo scoffed. What Jiraiya wanted is impossible. His death is but the latest example of it. He went to the Hidden Rain to try and understand and reason with his old students, which are now running the Akatsuki. And look where it got him. Ideals and good intentions don't bring peace. Only strength can do that. And your strength is a big part of that, Uzumaki.
Naruko had trouble arguing. Part of that was the pain of just having lost her sensei. Part of it was a deep fear that Danzo was right. And that, more than anything, left her feeling hopeless. It all simply felt so wrong, and she didn't know how to make it right. She was a ninja. She was trained to fight. But what enemy could she fight that would solve the core problem? Even if she destroyed the Akatsuki and the other villages, would the world she then find herself in have been worth it? It seemed that the only causes left to her were entirely selfish ones.
You are to leave for your assignments in 2 hours. Dismissed.
2 hours. 2 hours to decide what exactly. She had been told what she was supposed to do. Merely thinking that there was a decision to be made here was dangerous. So, what do we do now? Sakura asked in a soft voice when they were outside. I'll be honest, if it wasn't for you, I'd retire from being a ninja at this point. Please, I need you, Naruko said. Danzo's separating us anyway. Naruko paused to absorb a sliver of nature chakra, just enough so she could sense that they were indeed being overheard. She had expected as much. Just pack your bags for a very long mission, as we were instructed, and meet me at the top of the Okage Monument in about an hour. Sakura looked reluctant, but said, for you. And then she was gone. Naruko used shadow clones to make sure she was ready to leave much sooner, and so arrived at the Okage Monument with plenty of time to spare. She sat down on the stone face of her father, and looked through Jiraiya's letter. She hated how it almost seemed to validate Danzo's words. Indeed, he wrote that he had faith that she could bring peace to the ninja world. Because he himself gave up on it, she thought bitterly. Naruko flipped through the tale of the Gutsy Ninja, Jiraiya's first book, which encapsulated his beliefs perfectly. She started to read through it as if it contained all the secrets of the universe. Naruko knew that she had been named after the protagonist of the book, though her gender necessitated a minor adjustment. Naruto, in the book, was a shinobi very much like Jiraiya's ideal. Someone burning with ideals who never gave up. Naruko wished she could be like that.
This Naruto is pathetic,
the Kyuubi chose to comment. I'm not in the mood, Kyuubi. Jiraiya was proud of this book.
He is pathetic because he himself is part of the problem, even while claiming to never give up on finding a solution.
Naruko waited for more, but none was immediately forthcoming, as if the Kyuubi had already said its piece. Please, if you've got something to say, share it. I'm desperate enough to even listen to your opinion right now.
Very well. He claims to be searching for peace, but tell me, what is he doing throughout that entire book?
Protecting his village. That wasn't all, as the book also had several subplots going on. But that was the gist of it.
He is fighting in a war. He's like a man claiming to fix a drought while participating in a water fight.
What else is he supposed to do? Let his home be destroyed?
Why not? The book doesn't really go into details for why this war is happening. Except for a vague cycle of hatred. A book claiming to be about finding peace really should spend more time on the reasons behind the war. But I digress. Why not just stand aside? Let his village be destroyed. Wouldn't there be peace then?
Except for his own friends and family. They'd lose their home or might even be killed.
Indeed. You humans are a tribalistic lot by nature. This Naruto is no exception. He fights, and by the very act of doing so, he cannot help but push others down so his own tribe can survive and prosper. He'll fight for peace, but he'll only accept peace on his terms. A peace where he is the victor.
Naruto seems like a good man. If he wins, I doubt he'll take advantage of the losers. He just wants people to stop attacking him and his.
He isn't the leader of his village, though. Nor is he actively plotting to become one, so he has no say in what will happen to the losers.
Naruko let that sink in. Are you implying I should work to overthrow Danzo?
No. In the end, you humans are beyond saving, so it doesn't really matter what you do. I suppose you should just do what you like, since none of it'll matter in the end.
Well, that suggestion was pointless. If she had just done what she liked, she would have killed Gaara. Whether it be pointless or not, she had already decided she was going to do what was best for the world. Or trying to, at least. Sakura arrived soon after, and Naruko again made sure they weren't overheard. They weren't.
Their current locale was too open for someone to listen in on them without being noticed. That was why she had picked this place. Sakura, do you remember when we first started the academy? What being a shinobi meant to us at the time? Not in as much detail. At the time, I was just following Ino. The ninja academy was where all the cool kids went. Ah. Did you at least dream of saving small villages from monsters? Restoring princes to their rightful thrones? Stopping bandits, catching thieves? Be heroes. Yeah, I suppose I did dream those things. God, we were naive back then. Naive, yes. But were we wrong? Sakura took some time to answer. Well, we haven't saved many princes, caught thieves, or anything of the sort. The best that can be said is that we survived monsters. Yes, the reality of being a ninja is a lot more grim. But I don't really feel like accepting that reality. Sakura snorted. I'm the one with the illusions. Denying reality is supposed to be my job. Naruko smiled at her. I do not know how to fix the world. I'm not smart enough for that. What I do know is that we have been blessed with great power. What's the point of that if you don't use it to defend those who can't defend themselves? Sakura didn't know exactly where Naruko was going with this, but for some reason she knew she was going to like this and smiled. What are you getting at? I haven't lived through any wars, but I've heard enough stories from Jiraiya to know that it creates a lot of people who need help. That's what's important. I wish I could stop it all, but I can't. So I want to do what I can. I want to be a hero, like I'd always dreamed of being when I started the academy. And if being a loyal leaf ninja means I can't be that, then I have no further use for it. There, she said it. She, Naruko Uzumaki, was thinking of becoming a traitor. We're pulling a Sasuke, Sakura said. And Naruko was heartened by the fact she didn't seem opposed by the idea. Not quite. I don't intend to slink away like a thief in the night, letting everyone wonder what happened to me. That's really not my style anyway. The smile Naruko gave Sakura reminded her when she liked to pull pranks as a child. I'm going to let everyone know why we're going. We'll have to fight for half the Leaf Village if you do that, Sakura pointed out, still smiling. Which happens to be very empty right now, thanks to the war. I'll send clones to share the news with whatever old acquaintances are still here in the Leaf Village simultaneously. But all they know, I'm just trying to catch up with people before heading to the front lines. The real me and you are heading out as soon as possible. From her expression, Naruko already knew Sakura was on board. I want to tell my parents first, before we go. And Shizune, I have no doubt she'll want to come with us. Good, I'll go tell Kiba myself then. He won't turn us in. As it turned out, Kiba didn't just not turn them in, he offered to come along. As did Kakashi, who was with him at the time. I know too much of his dirty laundry. It's only a matter of time before Danzo will try to get me killed. And this is not the Konoha I grew up loving. Besides, you kids will need my help. Sakura's parents also decided to come along, at least for a short while. I don't want you to feel guilty, honey. We support your choice. But if we stay, we'll be used as hostages against you. We are retired, so we won't follow you into action. But we'll find somewhere to lay low and hide. Kiba's relatives were part of one of Konoha's biggest clans, so they enjoyed some protection. But Haruno's didn't have that luxury. And those were the only ones they informed personally. The rest were told the news by Naruko's clones. The reaction she got was mixed. Ino's parents were afraid. This would be a huge blow to the Leaf Village, and they feared for their new daughter's future, and asked Naruko to please reconsider. But Akubi did have a point somewhere when he accused humans of being tribalistic. If Naruko wanted to be a hero, she had to care about everyone. not just those she personally cared about. Protect the world, not just her world. Naruko really wanted to prove she could be better than the Kyuubi claimed, and forced him to eat his words. Konohamaru was angry, and swore he would one day bring her back home even if he had to break every bone in her body. He also managed to pop her clone with a very well executed sucker punch. Naruko was proud of him. Iruka seemed disappointed, but not in her. "This is a dark day for our village," he said. Chichi and Ayame, the owners of the Ichireko noodle shop, seemed mostly sad that they were losing a regular customer. Others ranged from horrified to angry to understanding, and some even to the point where they seemed to consider joining her. She couldn't accept, not right now. Clones were sharing the news and the real group was already running. Of course, pursuit was sent on their heels. Naruko tried to send clones in all directions, which fooled some of them, but most were still gaining on them. Naruko made quick work of them in Sage Mode, killing none of them, but leaving them bound and helpless. Mercy was a luxury afforded to the strong, and she hadn't quite realized how much Sage Mode elevated her into a different league than normal shinobi until now. She could handle the normal Chunin and Jonin sent after her like children. S-rank and Kage level ninjas might still be a threat to her, but not much else was. And that was ignoring the fact that Kakashi and Sakura were there, both probably also at a top tier of Konoha's strongest. Kakashi said that other than Danzo, the only one who might have stopped them was Mai's guy, and he wasn't in the Leaf Village right now, and probably wouldn't have stopped them in any event. What did surprise her, however, was when Danzo himself showed up. Both Naruko and Sakura had seen Danzo angry, annoyed, determined, diplomatic, reasonable. But this time the old man looked downright afraid. Aside from that one glance at his expression, Naruko closed her eyes. She didn't need her eyes to perceive the world in Sage Mode, and she was too wary of Danzo's Sharingan.
The Leaf Village needs you! Think of your father, your mother, all this sacrifice to keep the village safe. Don't spit on all that! Return and we'll come to an understanding!
As Naruko struggled to find a comeback, Kakashi put a hand on her shoulder. "I know your parents personally. I don't know if they'd approve, but they'd understand."
"I don't accept your answer, Lord Hokage," Naruko said. "Peace through domination isn't the way."
"It is the only way! Think, Uzumaki, with no allies, you're easy prey for the Akatsuki. You're just letting them win. Let me help you."
The longer they talked, the more reinforcements would arrive, and the bigger the chance of someone getting hurt. "Goodbye, Lord Hokage."
"The Leaf Village will be doomed without you!"
Danzo tried, but their group was fleeing again. A small army of Naruto clones stayed behind to cover their backs. They might have been able to outright win here, but if the resistance got too hard, they might not be able to leave their pursuers alive without risking themselves. None of them wanted to kill Leaf Ninja, so they focused on running. Eventually, pursuits had to be called off. The newly started Ninja War worked in Naruko's group's favor, as only so much resources could be spared to go after them. Naruko didn't know what her parents would think of her now. What she did know was that Jiraiya would be cheering her on, while also laughing at Danzo's misfortune.
"Watch me, Sensei. From now on, I'll be the hero you hoped I could be."
And that's the end of part 35, and the beginning of one of the biggest divergences from the canon plotline. Nikes out.